Salutations, my friends, and welcome back to TNO, which we're playing with Robert Francis Kennedy. Hope you're having a great day, but right now we're looking at the Senate, because in this episode, it's going to take some senators to get what we need done with malice towards none. But Mohammed, National Front, wins the Indonesian Civil War. Last time, of course, we did win the Indonesian Civil War for free Indonesia, but right now, we need to keep an eye on this. We have 40 center NPP senators, and the Republicans have 13, which is going to be important for what we're going to need to do to get maybe, hopefully, a bill passed. Oh, look at that. Oh, that's the flag of Australia. I didn't realize that. Cool. Australia, you have actually a really cool flag, led by Harold Holt. Oh, they're also liberal democracies. Do they not have a focus tree? Okay. That's kind of sad, but that's okay. The White Australia policy. Okay. A looming Japanese threat, of course, an unpopular draft. But yes, this is a beautiful Indonesia. I love the look of this Indonesia. Look how blue they are. They're so nice. So good. Look at that. So good. And the North Borneo administration. Who's over here? Japan or Brunei or something else? With malice towards none, though, my friends. With malice towards none. We could do this stuff, but nah, we good. So, I'll be honest here. Like, last time we started doing some of this stuff, fighting tyranny since 1776... I'm not really sure which one we need to do for slamming the door in their faces for civil rights or put the foot in the door. So I'm going to go with put the foot in the door. I have tried it with slam the door in their faces. This one's a much riskier one to do, but let's do this one. Many within the party center consider Republicans to be our natural allies in the fight for civil rights, separated from us only by party lines or drawn up in the chaos that followed the Second World War. Indeed, they'd voiced their support for the last act in the past, and the frustrations when Nixon vetoed it. Should we inevitably propose another, they may prove well to be better allies than our own party right. Negotiating with Senator Johnson is crucial for guaranteeing the act's passage. Success means a stable coalition that will advance and safeguard the civil rights of all Americans for the rest of the President Kennedy's term. And for that alone, compromise is worth the backlash the administration may receive from within the NPP. Excuse me. But if we had enough support already, we could do march straight forward, which would be really cool. And then the glorious bill, but we can't do that, so. Our divisions are back, great. In the name of bipartisanship. Pop-up attack school, our most pressing issue. And we can't do this. No, we cannot. However, we can continue to sideline the Dixiecrats. My apologies for my voice. I don't know what's wrong with it. But it always happens when I start recording. I don't know why. Maybe I'm going through a second puberty. Hopefully not. But stealth integration. Awesome. 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 Area defense? Might as well. This is one of the few campaigns where I'm actually going to try to maximize air doctrine. Or, you know, finish a tree at least. But I do want to keep in mind, though. Oh, our position secured. Today, after months of hard fighting across the archipelago, the Indonesian Civil War has come to an end, as Loyalist forces surrender in droves and Sukarno's top generals formally declare the fight over. With Sukarno ousted, the Popular Front of Free Indonesia is taking power. Comprised of anti-Sukarno Republicans, oppressed ethnic groups, communists, and Islamists, this ragtag army proved too strong for the Loyalist forces. Already, a democratic government is being set up in Jakarta, with much of the former rebel leaders taking up leadership positions. With the victory of Free Indonesia, the administration of Indonesia, of course, has seen a notable increase in popular approval. Having promised the defeat of Sukarno and the triumph of democracy, the president's promise appears to have become a reality. Exactly to what degree the U.S. support affected the Indonesian Civil War remains a matter of debate, but for now, America seems happy to see a favorable conclusion to the war. See, when you get RFK in, he can win in Africa, and then, like last episode, we just completely gave them all the freedom in the world, and we left, so they can fall apart and die, but the jungle finally cools. Awesome, gets more political power, stability, more national focuses. We grow a little bit more unified in America, less liberal democracy and conservative democracy, but we get more social democracy and authoritarian democracy. And the NPP grows more popular. Cool. Oh, wait. Well, I don't know why it made us not continue doing this one, but okay. Sure, why not? And we lost all progress on it. Isn't that great? So right now, Republican Democrat Party is willing to put aside their differences for now. The NPP is working together well, and American society is somewhat united. Cool. Let's see. Ooh, look, 0%. Nice. So there's a couple comments I want to get through. We have quite a bit of political power, so I don't mind. We will begin to increase our own influence here. Why not? 1%. 1% is good, right? No, CIA operations. We already did this last time. We filled the coffers, so we want to get as much support as possible. So I really want to pass civil rights, just to see what we can do with that as RFK and hopefully not die. Oh, look at Poland. Oh, Poland's here. But, oh man. Ooh, I don't know if Poland's going to stay there for long, though. But, yeah. I did want to see if we can get at least civil rights passed before the 1966 midterm elections and then the 68 elections, of course. So that'll be a lot of fun. But there's a couple other comments we should get to. Someone says, I should play as Sverdlovsk under Batov, as well as the Dovanga Brigade. Honestly, I've played in my own time as a Dovanga Brigade. It's not easy. It's really not easy. I'm not really sure what you can do as Dovanga except, like, die in the end. There's not really much you... I don't think there's much you can do. Have any of you guys played as Dovanga before? Because he's fun, but it's not like you can really expand... You kind of can expand eventually, but he's fun, but it's a little difficult. But let's go ahead and do Sideline the Dixiecrats. We'll strengthen the Civil Rights Act and get us a few votes at the risk of angering the far right. Someone did recommend I do this. Ooh, I hope we don't get assassinated. But there is, I think, an event coming up where we get another Supreme Court justice to curry the Republicans' favor by working together in legislation. We'll do this one, and then we'll sideline the Dixiecrats. In spite of the rhetoric and barbed politices, or politessa, and we and the Republicans share common values and ambitions towards America's ultimate betterment. It is perhaps only on relatively minor issues when we diverge in opinion and approach, though these differences are not so stark as to preclude hesitant tendrils of cooperation on both sides of the aisle. President Kennedy believes that reaching out to them with concessions to said issues will better incline them to work with the NPP in areas where bipartisanship has truly taken root, most notably in civil rights. Only together can we bring America back to good feeling, after all. And togetherness only begins when everyone has reason to join together at all. Cool. At the door stands ajar. The time has finally come to discuss civil rights on a national level. Our new Civil Rights Act is not as comprehensive as it could be, yes, but it's almost guaranteed support from the more liberal Republicans, which more radical legislation might not have. Plus, we can most likely count on support from moderate Republicans if we treat them with a certain level of respect. When it comes to civil rights, we most certainly need every iota of support we can muster. With this bill, we stand ready to help America live up to a dream of a free nation, where all are guaranteed life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The only real roadblock is all of the so-called brilliant minds and wonderfully colorful personalities of Congress, especially from the patriots of the NPPFR, or the far right. We owe to Americans of all races, colors, and creeds to do our gosh darn hardest to get this act passed, and to create a nation where we can finally, really finally say, that everyone is created equal. We certainly have got a work cut out for us, but it's worthwhile work indeed. A moderate bill is the only one we can hope to pass. RFK will be seen as a more liberal candidate. Oh. I don't know, man. I don't want him to go bye-bye before 68, so we'll do the best we can. If we get any option to, we are definitely going to try to make him go as conservative as possible now. Keep spending more money, because why not? Do have a cup of coffee here and some water to keep us nice and hydrated. And our debt is only 114.49. However, we got to remember... Oh, the Central Siberian Federation. Oh, look, it wasn't Tomsk that formed them. It was Novosibirsk. Cool. I think. Cool. And it's 65. We can do that. Let's grab some military construction 3. That'd be very good. Sverdlovsk. I don't know anything about you, actually. Oh, okay. It's by Rokovsky. Cool. The Lion of Siberia. Moderel secures Breton leadership. New Russian army. The Ural Ultimative Plant. Recon groups. How is this news? Huh. Brittany, what are you up to? Moderel. Our Russian expeditions. Ooh, that's kind of cool. Weekly manpower goes down, though. That's not good. Uh-oh. And Sverdlovsk unifies West Siberia. Cool. African expeditions. That's cool. The Ermine Seal. Huh. And the Bezin Perol. Cool. Provisional Commissariat of Western Russia, led by Vlasov Despot of the Ural Military District now. Collapse of the Underground State Unity. Oh, there goes military austerity. And there's you guys, of course. Goodbye. And Reichskommissariat Poland. Oh, Reichsprotectorate. Oh, Albert Forster. So they just kind of gave up. They didn't even fight. Which I guess makes some sort of sense. And Kazakh Soviet Socialist Republic is here too. Cool. If only the Far Eastern Soviets, or not Soviet, but Russian nations would figure out who's going to win, that'd be great. So, I guess out on the Dixiecrats. As always, Wallace, Thurman, and their far-right Dixiecrats remain headaches to work with. They have not offered the slightest bit of compromise in the issues of civil rights, instead content with wailing and screaming about their sacrosanct states' rights whenever approached. To outsiders, they are a putrid stain on the NPP. To supporters, they are a testament to the NPP's duplicity and hypocrisy. And to the NPP itself, they are a metastasizing cancer willing to throw away party unity for selfish gain. Owing to our weak position in Congress, we once had no choice but to seek their support in order to buttress the NPP's votes. Times have changed, however, and now we are in the position to make do without theirs. For President Kennedy, now is the best time to boot these unjumped rattlesnakes and alligators out of the party he leads. Strengthen the Civil Rights Act and give us a few votes at the risk of angering the far right. I don't want to piss him off too much. The beginning of a beautiful friendship. America is divided more than ever on seemingly every issue: economic policy, military intervention, civil rights, and just about whatever else we can fit on the nightly news. For now, more than ever, however, we must bring Americans together and create a more free, equal America. That said, a free, equal America requires a lot of work to turn from fantasy to fact. The first step is to secure bipartisan support in the Congress, and our best bet is some kind of coalition with more liberal Republicans. Let's show the Republicans that our values are quite similar by working on a War Powers Act together, which would limit the President's power to unilaterally plunge America into war, like in South Africa. If they learn to work, or like working with us on this, support for a future Civil Rights Act would almost be guaranteed. We must keep the prize in sight, and lead the Republicans to an area. Yeah, it's a Britain Revolution. Yeah, first draft. Oh boy. Can this home of the workers survive? Costin. Wait, this is the same guy I think that rose up when I was playing as Shostakovich, wasn't it? Yeah. What happened to that other guy? And the Novus Liberus people. Ooh, this coffee's not bad. The first draft, though. Congress and really all of politics is a tricky game. How far do you push your morals in favor of pragmatism? What a vote's really worth, and more. With this bill, we face with a certain decision we must make as we draft the WPA. Do we make the act as clear and direct as possible, or do we leave a few loopholes here and there? Making an airtight bill would certainly be the more moral choice and perhaps the most popular, but if we leave a few loopholes, we could satisfy some of the war hawks in Congress. Focus more on what is right than realistic. Let's go. We came here to prevent another South Africa. Close the loopholes. Oh, I don't know. Oh, maybe not. Airtight bill. Most popular, but we leave a few loopholes, we could satisfy some of the warhawks. I think compromise is the way we want to go. Focus on more what's realistic rather than what's right. Grumbles in the... I really don't know. Prevent another South Africa. I kind of like South Africa. We'll see what happens. Happy 1966, though, my friends. Hopefully no one dies, but grumbles in the NPPFR. Some far-right members of the NPP are complaining that we gave the executive branch too much power in the War Powers Act. They fear that we'll do the same when it comes to civil rights, which they feel as undue government tyranny. This, of course, is absurd, but we could count on more complete congressional support if we alter the language of the act somewhat, even if it means we might scare off a few Republicans. I don't want to get assassinated, but... Okay, so I'm not exactly sure how it's going to work, because if we have the center NPP and the Republicans, we have 53 votes. I think maybe a few Democrats might vote, and this is only saying if all Republicans and center NPP vote together. So, I don't want to get assassinated yet, so let's go to the elephant blows its trunk first. Just a few altercations, just a few alterations, I should say. The elephant blows its trunk. After altering the language of the War Powers Act to please the NPP far right, the Republicans are worried that they'll just bend over to the NPPFR when it comes to civil rights. They consider we won't stick to our guns and get a square deal for Americans, with LBJ himself trumpeting this line from every talk show in the nation. Unfortunately, it's too late to back out of the alterations, but hopefully the act will still make it out of Congress with a new FR support. This does not bode well for our future cooperation. Oh well. Why does bipartisanship have to be so hard? Well, that sucks. If we can't pass it, then so be it. You know, it is what it is. It was my goal that hopefully we could. The passing of the War Powers Act. With the recent Senate vote, the War Powers Act is on its way to Robert's desk, which means a victory for us and our coalition. Hypothetically, this should mean that we've achieved a great success for bipartisanship in America, but it seems that we've just, like, dug up the party trenches even deeper. We set out not only to prevent another South Africa, but to show America how to work together again, and while we get the job done in the end, the cracks we got along the way are worrying. So, what's done is done. We must look towards the future and not the past. There will likely be another opportunity to showcase bipartisanism soon, and to guarantee the Republicans that we'll work with them when it comes to civil rights. Political power, stability, drafting the Environmental Protections Act. Oh boy. And we get that event hopefully very soon. We got a lot of political power, wow. Cool. Drafting the Environmental Protections Act. America has always been a land of progress, with each new era bringing new innovations and opportunities through wonders of science and industry. But progress comes with a cost. The ravages of unchecked development has waged devastation upon the great beauty of nature, and the skies choke with smog just as the land lies swashed with waste. Something must be done to ensure that we do not squander the bounty of our great country. Our new bill would introduce a slew of environmental protections and regulations aimed at reducing the impact of human development on the natural world. Businesses and government institutions would be encouraged to monitor and reduce their reliance on polluting chemicals, inefficient practices, and irresponsible waste disposal, among other such ills. Certain incentives that help encourage the adoption of green policies are also included in the bill, including increased taxation on pollutive products and subsidies for organizations that adopt environmentally friendly initiatives. Before we submit the bill, we must figure out our strategy. Our cooperation with the Republican Democrats has presented an opportunity we may be able to exploit in this matter. A number of Democrat senators have expressed a great passion for the cause of environmental protection, and if we were to offer them a seat at the table to help draft the bill, we could show up to their support when it comes to time to vote. On the other hand, their passion may prove rather counterproductive, as they will certainly request that we include even stronger protections that may not prove as palatable to the rest of the government. The decision lies with President Kennedy, who is willing to pursue any avenue in the interest of defending America's natural beauty. In times like this, must BC safe? Oh, crap. Oh, wait. Oh, who do we want more, Democrats or Republicans? Because we have 30 Democrats. We have 13 Republicans. The far-right requests amendments. It's best to be safe. Yeah. We're going to invite the Democrats. Totally. Absolutely. If I can get like half the Republicans and half the Democrats with us, with the Senate NPP, well, that'll be more than fine with me. So, a firmer hand on the environment. The Democrats have been eager to work with us in developing the Environmental Act, and lengthy discussions about the bill's contents have been taking place over the last few days. As expected, however, our decision to include them may come at a cost. While they welcome the protections offered by the bill, the Democrats say they did not go far enough, for they claim that sufficiently wealthy and powerful organizations should be freely able to ignore the regulations if the profit remains sufficient, rather than a carrot we need to stick, they say. Among the proposed amendments include rendering certain particularly ecologically damaging practices illegal, with significant fines and sanctions for those companies who continue to engage in them. In addition, they also seek the creation of a government watchdog that would be able to investigate organizations that flaunted environmental law and enforce fines on those they find in violation of the regulations. Though these suggestions would certainly make a difference for the environment, there are many who would balk at such an interventionist approach. Passing the bill with their amendments attached may prove even more difficult than we had just tried to do alone, and maybe better to quit while we're ahead and get the Democrats back out of the discussions. Opening the door only to slam them back in their faces, however, might not be the best look for us. Middle ground? Oh, come on. It'll be tough, but they're right. It was a bad idea to reject the amendments. I'm not going to do that. I can't do that. But they're right. Make it stronger. Ooh. This might not get anything passed. I don't want to do this. I don't want to decrease the Republican goodwill, because we've already done that once. I can't do that. It'll be tough, but they're right, make it stronger. This is not going to get passed, is it? An avalanche of calls. When President Kennedy opened the morning paper to find the draft of the Environmental Act staring back at him from page 3, he had cursed under his breath. Some careless staffer must have left a copy lying around for any old gumshoe journalist to find, and now the full draft of the bill is available for all to see. Already there was some consternation in the papers about the Democrats' amendments, and President Kennedy groaned at the knowledge that he had no doubt drawn the ire of some very powerful people. At 9:30, the first phone call arrived, and they would seemingly never cease until well into the evening. Many different people could be heard on the other end, but they could have essentially been considered the same. All a bunch of lobbyists. Lobbyists for Mobil, Pacific Gas and Electric, Chevron, all manner of names that held so much clout in places that they really shouldn't. The calls were generally brief, but equally terse, and with all the same message, stop it. The demands of the lobbyists were simple. Dilute the terms of the bill and cease trying to cut into their profits. If the government refused, they vowed to use whatever resources that were at their disposal to drown the NPP in bad press and flood the heartlands of the oil and energy industries with ads attacking the party. Heartlands like the Southwest and Midwest, where the companies were essentially institutions in their own right, where the working man looked to provide his daily bread. Certainly, now men who take kindly to the great corporate benefactors, not being able to create as many jobs due to government meddling. By sundown, President Kennedy was no longer hiding his cursing. He knew that he was in a bind and was faced with a choice. If he continued down this path, he'd almost certainly lose much of the Midwestern states, and quite possibly the next election. But was it defiance of the natural world, and defense of the natural world, and the great green earth that he and 3 billion people shared not more important than votes? With one final expletive, he picked up the now silent phone and called the bill drafting committee, ready to at last to inform them of his decision. You know what? I'll be honest. I want RFK to be a one-term president anyways, so I don't really care about the midterm elections. If anything, I want the Republicans and Democrats to do well, so lobbyists be god-danged. This is for the future. Yes. Because apparently, if RFK is a very high chance of getting assassinated, like, eventually. So, keep doing this, too. Build up the Midwestern states if we can. Well, a portion of the Midwestern states. Do that, too. There you go. And the Environmental Act actually passes. After all the haggling, debating, and careful politicking over the last few months, our environmental bill has finally passed through the halls of power and emerges law. With only the formality remaining being the signing of the bill into law by President Kennedy's own hand, a new dawn awaits for this fair land of America. No more will selfish corporations be permitted to blindly squander the natural beauty of our country in the name of a quick profit. Nor will the government itself turn a blind eye to the abuses against fair Mother Nature. Not only is this a great day for natural splendor, but also a great day for everyone in the halls of power. Our close cooperation with the Republican Democrats in getting this bill through proves just how much the government can achieve when it stops bickering amongst itself, and instead finds common ground. Many with the RD party ranks, and perhaps more pertinently within their own electorate, have come to look upon this with ambivalence, if not outright favor, where we would have only been hostility. And in the future, we may be able to count on their votes to back up our very own. A few quiet polls and queries among Capitol Hill representatives have revealed that polls across the country have shifted as well. Let's hope we've earned some favors. Remove few pollution regulations. Where is that? Social laws, pollution, few... So we go from this to strict regulation. So we have this one. So basically, we go all the way up to strict regulations. Oh, crud. So we get more monthly population. We lose output, dockyard output, construction spending factor. 120%. Oh, God, no. I did the wrong thing. Oh, no. Not more spending. No. The GDP. Oh, God. Minus... Oh. 2.19. Maybe she has to stop spending so much for civilian stuff. Hey, infiltration specialization, though. That's nice. Because once we're done building up more civilian factories, I'm going to be cutting construction spending by quite a bit. The fruits of cooperation. Our bipartisan efforts to secure support across the aisle have earned us praise, and the Senate whips have been dispatched to count up the votes. Let's hope that the Republicans come through. The real prize awaits. We can now see how many Republicans will support our civil rights bill through the decision menu. Ooh. 13. There's only 13 of them, though, which really sucks. Dealing with the far right, international... Ooh, kind of went... We have quite a bit of political power. Hey, 1% every month, not bad. It's only 20 if you do that. Let's see. Decisions. Because we still can see this. I mean, this doesn't change until elections. So... And how much do we get every day? Ooh, the Class 2 Senate election season. The U.S. is once again gearing up for the election season. As per the Constitution, all seats in the House of Representatives and a third of the Senate seats will be for grabs in November, along with innumerable states and local races across the nation, and the course of American politics will change with it. Status quo or radical upheaval, it's time for the people to decide. If you want to read about this, we've read this like 2 or 3 times already, so... Ooh, which one do I want? You know what? I think, because I'm still trying to pass civil rights right now. I'm going to go with NPP for now. Because once things get really bad, I'm going to make sure that we lose some support later on. Cool. So let's go help elect the NPP for now. Toss up in the Rockies, it looks like. Again, of course. Rockies, Great Plains. Yeah, so let's do Great Plains. Why not? We want as much support for now as possible. I don't really care about the election. I just want to get stuff passed for now. So... Oh, that debt. Oh, and I gotta keep in mind the great oil crisis that's gonna happen later on, too. Oh, boy. Actually, we get 0.83. You know what? Revelations with him, well, they're gone. Shifting Irish politics towards democracy? I could try that. Sideline Dixiecrats? Cool. Hopefully we don't die. God, I hope we don't die. Meeting with the civil rights leaders, though. Or our most pressing issue. Oh, okay. Let's try that one. Segregation in the U.S. has become by far the single most contentious issue of our times, dwarfing the impact of even our foreign affairs. Neighbors spit on neighbors for the color of their skin. Activists clash in the streets, fighting for the future or the past. The Senate floor is dominated with endless debates and inter-party conflict and even intra-party conflict. While this goes on, America cannot call itself a united country, and the chaos will only continue to build if nothing is done. It falls to our administration to resolve this generational debate once and for all. As we get involved in Irish politics. Also, let's see, other comments. Someone said, basically, the African states are going to get content later on. They are, especially the ones that we get involved in. But they're pretty much usually almost always dedicated to fail, which kind of sucks, but it's Africa. What do you expect? It's a fun nation. Fun nation? Fun nations to play as. Really cool. The reason I want to keep maybe influencing England a little bit more is because someone's just recommended that I do. That was a comment from yesterday, so I don't mind. 2.5%, you know what? There might be a bug where we can still get them under us, so, or with us. The Russo Finnish ceasefire signed. Perfidious Finns escape justice against again, dragging their feet. Thurman is no stranger to the filibuster. Blather, waste time, drag your feet, swaddle everything in red tape. Weigh the issue down in chains and throw it in the Potomac. Him and his cronies will do anything to slow down the cause of justice, so President Kennedy wasn't surprised to find out that he was doing it again. The president lightly hung up the receiver of the phone, fists balled, jaw clenched. He wanted to slam it down, but refused to give the corpulent old toad the satisfaction of seeing him riled. So that was that. After all the talks, and the schmoozing, and the glad-handling, and the endless, effing, heart-rending compromises, Thurman and his goons were just going to dig their heels in the mud and refuse to move, like an ornery camel. All that work wasted just so the right-wingers of the party could keep their flagging dream of segregationist future alive. So much for bipartisanship. Bipartisanship. Kennedy narrowed his eyes on it as an idea formed. Drumming his fingers on his desk, he wondered if this was entirely wise. If he did this, he would forever alienate the rightists by cutting them out of the legislative process of the administration. Screw them, he thought. They were trying to do the same thing to him. Difference was, he was the president. Smirking as he picked up the receiver, Kennedy dialed the office of LBJ, Lyndon Baines Johnson. Senator Thurman, your ship has sailed. Yeah, once we're done with building infrastructure, there's not going to be a lot more to do for us to build it in America. I mean, I'm going to build up like a crap ton of nuclear reactors and radar stations, just in case we get maybe attacked nuclearly, but you know, whatever. And then we'll do Rockies. Rockies. This coffee's pretty good, too. How are we already like 25 minutes into this video? I never understand. I really enjoy, you know, TNO. Too much, probably. What do we have? Let's see. Look over here. What is our OFN? Not OFN. Black market trading. A solid MPP campaign. Great. Good work, everyone. Good work. So it is light. It's just light. I know. I guess that makes sense. Oh, they run a masterful campaign. Oh, that's not good. Under any circumstances, gotta hand it to them. Ooh, that's not good. I know about this time. I don't know. Because are machine guns still banned in the United States? I'm going to say yes. I'm not sure they are. But you know what? No, I don't want... We have political power, but I do know we need to keep saving it. But I'm going to spend it for this instead. But, ooh. Are machine guns still... I got to assume that they're still banned, right? Oh my gosh, we're done with civilian factories? No. We got to build up Nebraska. I'm not going to have any more space to build like military factories if I keep doing this. But, like, I'm pretty sure machine guns are probably still banned, right? Yeah. So that's why, I guess that makes sense for light black arms tradings. But then again, where do you even buy that stuff? Of course, you can convert stuff, but never mind. Never mind. So, let's meet with civil rights leaders. And actually, we can't do this one. The Civil Rights Act has to reach the floor. The reputation of Wallace was accompanied by a sudden influx of support for the American civil rights community. This cause and effect relationship is easy to explain after all. They'd suffered more than most from the Jim Crow laws, our now diminished party right has enthusiastically advocated. Siding with their erstwhile coalition meant siding with those who had made them and their forebears' lives slavery long after it was abolished. An opportunity to work closer with these advocates for freedom has presented itself in front of us. Having done away the party's garbage, President Kennedy can now formally reach out to the colored men and women at the forefront of the civil rights movement. Co-opting their strength will be a boon like no one other for the NPP, and nothing breaks the ice better than bonding over the woes of a shared enemy. Pretty much. Not bad. I'm just worried about the GDP. Into the jaws of democracy. It's been a long and grueling work to get to this point, but we can finally say with no small amount of pride that the Civil Rights Act has officially reached the Senate. It's a small victory, and we still have miles of the winding halls of bureaucracy to guide our bill through, but it is a victory nonetheless. No time to celebrate, however, because our bill is now firmly in the gaping maw of American democratic republicanism. In order to debut on the Senate floor, the bill must pass the Senate Judiciary Committee, which is currently headed by one James Oliver Eastland, a bona fide, card-carrying, rabid segregationist. Under normal circumstances, we might just let him have his way and delay the bill in perpetuity so we don't rock the boat too much. However, these are not normal circumstances. The Civil Rights Act must be made into law as these United States are to continue to call themselves the defenders of freedom, equality, and true democracy in the dark, fever dream of the world. As such, it is necessary that we get this bill passed Eastland and onto the Senate floor. What options should we pursue? Give Lyndon Baines Johnson a call. Oh boy. We're going to go with the Rockies. Rockies. Great Plains. We kind of did okay. RDs. MPP with a small lead. I want to get everything passed before the election. So, the phone call. LBJ. Landslide Lyndon. Jumbo in some circles. Love him or hate him, he might just be the most effective Senate whip in American history. He runs the goddamn Senate like his personal kingdom, and it might as well be. When LBJ dies, that man will just give St. Peter the Johnson treatment until they let him in. He might not be able to sell snow to an Eskimo, but god dang, if that Eskimo ain't gonna end up with a few pounds of snow one way or another. More to the point, however, he's an influential, powerful, and experienced political figure, and he's sympathetic to the civil rights cause. He was an obvious choice to help the Civil Rights Act to get through Eastland's committee, and he's come up with a rather ingenious solution. According to a few archaic bylaws and regulations, we could just push this bill right past the Judiciary Committee and out on the Senate floor. LBJ's help is greatly appreciated, but at the same time, if we go for his plan and force the bill into a vote, we'll piss off the NPP far right even more, and they may end up filibustering the bill. If they do filibuster, the act is dead in the water, and who knows where we stand. Do we take a risk and hope they don't filibuster, or do we just pray Eastland lets the bill through? I mean, they can just filibuster all they want. Doesn't mean that we can't do other stuff, but I guess we'll go with the Johnson plan. Let's get LBJ on board for now. Meet with civil rights leaders, and then talk with Malcolm X. We can't do this. If they've not reached the floor yet, we could probably ignore doing this for now. What we see more as a liberal candidate. Oh, I don't want to increase my liberalism too much to those who know best. The power will increase. Oh, this is going to get me killed. This is going to get me killed. Let's talk with Malcolm X. He's actually a very interesting fellow. Malcolm X is the most vociferous and aggressive, definitely the most controversial, civil rights advocate in the modern American political landscape. Leader of the Nation of Islam, he pontificates passionately against injustices meted to the black man by his old slave master across the South. Yet the solution he proffers for America's racial divide mirrors that of the white man he so loves. Not to heal it, but to widen and deepen it, this time on the black man's own initiative. His words are appalling and offensive to the sensibilities of many, nevertheless. Hatred runs deep and far for the many thousands who take him to heart. Organizing a meeting with such a radical figure will doubtlessly cause a backlash amongst the more integration minded of our country and party. Hope remains that an impasse may be reached, however, and President Kennedy has worked with far less than hope before. Please, can a Supreme Court justice just die so we can get some more conservative support so we don't die immediately? Oh my goodness. The Act's debut. Johnson's plan went off without a hitch. Our little loophole is being tied up as we speak, but we shot the Civil Rights Act clear through the Judiciary Committee and right onto the Senate floor. Johnson just goes to show that there's still such a thing as a good Republican, one who's willing to work across party lines for what's the best for American people. Unfortunately, we were right about pissing off the NPP far right. Eastland and Thurman have been spending what seems like every waking moment complaining to the press. Funny how every single thing we do is a tyrannic scandal unseen since the time of Benedict Arnold. In any case, we weren't counting on the NPP far right anyways, or the other votes. The bill's on the floor, but it's not quite time for it to go to vote. All we can do now is court a few more votes and pray that the NPP far right doesn't filibuster. Fingers crossed, this is a new dawn for America. Oh boy. An auspicious meeting. We already know that the nation was watching our efforts to pass the Civil Rights Act with bated breath. Perhaps, however, we didn't quite realize how bated that national breath was. Recently, both Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X have jointly asked to come speak to President Kennedy about the struggle for civil rights. While MLK and Malcolm X have certainly had, and continue to have, their differences, MLK emphasizes peaceful protest while Malcolm X champions civil rights by ballot or by bullet. They certainly agree that civil rights is the most important issue that these United States face, and they agree that a joint request to speak to RFK will have more weight and importance than two separate requests. Frankly, they're right. Combined, they have the weight of the most of America's black population behind them. That level of public support is hard to ignore. Plus, it's just the right thing to do to get the perspectives of actual civil rights leaders as we attempt to pass our own Civil Rights Act. On the other hand, inviting them to the White House will certainly lead to an outcry from certain choice elements in Congress. Do we take them up to the initiative or their invitation? Should we talk over lunch? Oh, we're going to die. We are going to get bullet to the head. Probably a 22, but that's just me. Well, that's just Robert. Hey, we already dealt with the RFK. We filled their coffers. You got to remember what we did for you. increase their influence, because why not? 7%. I could have done this before, but I don't really care. You just want to focus on GDP, please? Well, with the oil crisis later on and the guy we want to elect later on, GDPs are not going to really be there for us. Not too much growth, probably. Ooh. Toss up. Let's close it. So, there's a few RDs here. Not too bad for us, though. Really not too bad. We got a lot of social democracy. So, talk with Malcolm X. At this point, I think I'm done boosting the civilian budget. I want to be done because we're starting to run out of, like, things to build. Because we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 7 lines of 20 out of 20 plus 1. So, I think we're kind of done with that for now. Actually, I could slash it, but I still want more political power. But we can wait. Hand in hand. Do I keep going with Consult King and Those Who Know Best? Civil Rights Act is currently not being filibustered. Ooh. You know what? Let's go down here as fast as we can, because this all of this takes is a week. So, let's do hand-in-hand first. Despite their stark differences, President Kennedy and Senator Johnson have frequent and productive meetings in the Oval Office as of late, where they discuss the finer points of the Work in Progress Act. These meetings often last from morning to midnight, involving copious amounts of pens, paper, cigarettes, and hard liquor. Whatever words were exchanged between the two and reports abound from anonymous staffers are particularly coarse language being liberally employed. They both leave having taken two more steps towards the Act's final version. Such displays of the inter-party cooperation has since motivated other MPP and Republican congressmen, especially those who are both belong in committees, to work together for the cause which they both wish to advocate or advance. Hand in hand, none can stop us from together delivering the American people the rights from which they truly deserve. Oh God, oh God, it'll be sent to the vote. Ooh. It'll be sent to the floor for a vote. Oh boy, if they filibuster it, we can still talk with King, right? Oh man, oh no. Actually, how much do we get every day? Points, still not bad. 0.74 is still not bad. Coffee with Malcolm. El Haj Malik El Shabazz, better known as Malcolm X, was not an easy man to talk to. Opinionated and brusque, he exhibited none of the fawning typical of guests to the White House. Talking with Malcolm X, though, was, thought Kennedy, rather like being hit in the face repeatedly by medieval mace. After a youth spent as a petty criminal, he had found religion in prison with the Nation of Islam, quickly became the organization's public face and a major spokesperson for racial justice. Though differing from many other black leaders due to his racial separatist ideals, Malcolm X has over time become one of the most prominent and outspoken figures fighting for racial equality, none to mention the most controversial, no matter which side of the debate you're on. As he sipped his coffee, wine, of course, would be haram. Listening to Ethel and Malcolm's wife, Betty, exchanging stilted small talk at the other end of the table, Kennedy wondered if meeting with Malcolm X had been such a good idea. Malcolm X seemed skeptical, and frankly, Kennedy couldn't blame him. After hundreds of years of getting sidelined by white politicians, why should Malcolm X trust him? Kennedy wished he could somehow show the man what lay in his heart, his genuine commitment to justice, to racial equality, to bettering the lives of African Americans. In the end, both men felt frustrated. Kennedy wondered if it had been a foregone conclusion as the phone began to ring, and incensed Thurman on the other hand. Nobody can give you freedom. If you're a man, you take it. Oh, man, that's not good. That's not good. If I don't complete this... Ooh... They said how many... Actually, how's this campaign going? Opposition's campaign. We'll see about that. Oh, campaign in the Rockies. They run a respectable campaign. Well, good for them. Rockies, Great Plains. That's the main one I'm a little worried about. Small lead, area defense. Ooh, South integration. Nice. We might do Deep South next as well. Just for funsies. Alright, let's do air tasking order. Cool. Support here. Let's get some... we don't really need military police. Anything for 66? Yes. Let's do Deep South. A solid... Hey, great! A solid campaign. We love that. So, didn't they say that we could, like, help out or, like, increase support or something? Increase party unity? More likely to vote for us even if they feel closer to an opposing candidate? I never do that one. Maybe we'll do it just to see what happens. We did this last time. That's way too ahead of time. Ooh. What else we got here? APCs, tanks. We got those. Actually, let's go back to industry. Refining synthetic oil. Resource efficiency gain. Oh, let's do this one. Cap and output. We got all this political power, but when am I supposed to use it? Increase party unity? Ooh, annex daylight savings times. Or daylight savings. Seasons bring not only snow melts and browning leaves, but also there are preferences over whether the sun rises and sets. Whereas winter prefers to grace her rolling white panoramas with an extra hour of warmth sunset light, summer instead bids the star wake an hour early, as if to greet the sleeping peoples under its watchful gaze. Romans, Englishmen, Frenchmen, civilizations which have relied on the sun's firmamental flight to keep track of time were left with no choice but to adjust their hours to four different maidens' tastes. Today the U.S. shall enjoy their lengthy hallowed ranks as President RFK signs the Uniform Time Act of 1966. Its pages decree that from... basically, 0200 hours of April's last Sunday to 0200 hours of October's last Sunday, all clocks across America's five time zones shall be moved forward by exactly 1 hour. Proponents have argued for a multitude of benefits saving daylight in such a manner will bring, including a notable reduction in home electricity bills. Should they somehow wish, states may choose to opt out of their latest and most unusual amendment to the nation's timekeeping standards, provided their exemptions apply statewide. Remember, kids, spring forward and fall back. I never do this. They're working together... Well, what if I did that more? Could that give us even more? You know what? I'm gonna try it. I don't think it'll do much for us. Did I click on it? Oh, okay. Cool. Just to see what happens. I don't think anything was actually gonna happen, so. Now I'm just spending political power like it means nothing. Cool. 40. 45 MPP. Military austerity, yeah, no, goodbye. Actually, if we cut civilian spending right now, that would not be bad. 38 billion? Yeah, we could. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, some. But I don't want to lose any more political power, because I am spending quite a bit, so. And how are we doing? Oh, yeah, this dude, deep south. The Rockies are still a toss-up. Yeah. Oh, the Great Plains aren't doing bad. We're doing better than the Great Plains now, it looks like. Maybe. Oh, and there goes Austin. Oberkommando Brauchitstadt. Cool. Political landscape. We're here. 55 national progressive senators. Oh, the congressional situation. We can only have 40 votes, which is not enough to pass laws. We have also... Oh, here it is. We've also secured 27 votes outside our voting block for the next piece of legislation with 0 votes for our next piece of legislation? Outside our voting block for our next piece. State of the Supreme Court. Okay, hand in hand. So we can't do that yet. We probably have to wait. Civil Rights Act is currently not being filibustered. I guess we have to consult with King? Contrasting Malcolm X's firebrand rhetoric of black supremacy, our Martin Luther King Jr.'s sermons of peace and friendship over our fellow man. He preaches straight into the hearts of millions every Sunday mass with a smooth baritone that soothes and inflames the soul in equal measure, clamoring for the average Joe to seek their conscience. Join hands and march forward together towards a future shared by Americans of all races and faiths. Truly, one cannot ask for a better spokesperson for the civil rights movement than a good reverend and the word of God. Connecting with a community that requires learning from its mores and customs, so that no issue will arise from interacting with them. No one will know a flock of sheep better than their own shepherd, and Dr. King may be more ecstatic than most in helping the president help his own. This might not be good to do. A welcome surprise. As soon as the Civil Rights Act hits the Senate floor, everyone tensed up for obvious inevitable filibuster, most likely from Thurman and his ilk. The thing is, however, the filibuster never came. The act is set to move into voting procedure very soon, all in all without a hitch. This is a big win, not just for us, but for the American people. We can focus on directly securing votes and generally preparing the final vote on the act without scrambling to react to some absurd 24-hour-long filibuster, and that means we have a much better chance of passing the Civil Rights Act. We have therefore ever closer to reaching that perfect American shrine in the Constitution, a land where all are equal and free, judged by the conduct of action and content of ideas, not skin, not color of skin. The Civil Rights Act is very far from a done deal, and we can't yet put up our feet and pat ourselves on the back. We can, however, breathe a sigh of relief. We've jumped one less hurdle on the road to a fair, free America. Looks like Strom knows when to shut up. Hold on. If I can... We can do it. Screw it. Oh, can we cancel this? Let's cancel that. We're going to the Civil Rights Act right now. An act to enforce the constitutional right to vote. To confer jurisdiction upon the district courts of the USA. To provide injunctive relief against discrimination and public accommodations. To authorize the Attorney General to institute suits to protect constitutional rights in public facilities and public education. To extend the Commission on Civil Rights to prevent discrimination in federally assisted programs. To establish a Commission on Equal Employment Opportunity and for other purposes. The titles draw legal ease, but do not be fooled by its outward appearance. The Civil Rights Act heralds the greatest flowering of American political freedom since the Bill of Rights, searing into the country's book of law the rights withheld to select citizens in many of its states. Millions of Americans will see their fortunes improve at last, breathe true freedom at last, witness jubilo at last, should this act pass the baptism of Congress. The fate of millions now hang in the balance, as do the sacrifices we've made to reach this point. Pray that our lawmakers will listen to their conscience and make the right choice. We will go with the final vote on the Civil Rights Act. We must make sure we have at least 50 votes necessary to pass it before going forward. The final vote. Oh god. You know what? We might as well do it now. We're already over 40 minutes into this video. We've got 40 from the center, which I'm pretty sure they'll all vote this way. If we get at least 11 Republicans, and maybe like a Democrat or two, maybe, we can do it. Obviously, the far right isn't going to do it. But we have secured 27 votes outside our voting block for our next piece of legislation. So that should be good, right? That should be good. Oh god. Oh god. Because I've done this before, and I failed the Civil Rights Act before. And I don't want to do this because we don't want to be seen as more too liberal. Just too liberal. Oh man. Ooh. The Dixiecrats will trust us less if we go through this. Ooh. Well, we have to do this to get down here. And justice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Oh, boy. The Civil Rights Act has finally become law of the land, and congressmen and laymen alike celebrate their victory. Despite bellicose rhetoric tinged with a southern twang aimed at the righteousness of our cause, millions of dollars spent on defaming and harassing our leading figures and humble rank and file, and colorful broadcasts meant to turn the American public against us, despite aggressive assaults from cankerous, hateful racists, 20 million Americans can now truly exercise the rights which they take for granted, but the struggle for the true equality is yet to be won. Obstacles remain for the colored man to hurdle, ones which had centuries to entrench themselves into the American system, invisible or otherwise, to pervade and corrupt the various institutions which proclaim to deliver liberty and justice for all. For now, we shall revel in this seminal moment in America's history. Let us take care, however, not to grow complacent in our laurels, lest we see our current success undone. Now, this will cancel if we don't get it passed. Oh, God. I was keeping out this too. That's kind of important to see. We got 14 days. Oh, man. Oh, the road towards justice. Social justice isn't easy, and President Kennedy has made and only will make more enemies in his later campaign for social justice. Encompassing further investigation reforms into the prison system, schooling, and legal system, RFK will need to make sure he keeps his friends close and his enemies closer. Fight against poverty, seen as more liberal society, or the poverty societal right will begin to improve. Campaign where we haven't. We lose money in our reserves. The center grows more popular. Campaign is where we haven't. In our weakest states, we must work towards putting our campaign money. Let America know that no matter your home state, Kennedy fights for you. Ooh, that's not bad. Fight for the schools. More liberal. And we'll gain support from unions and his radical base. Fight for the workers. This is probably too late to do. The final vote? Oh, God. The vote on the civil rights has not only been days, weeks, or months in the making. It has not been years or even decades in the making. The Civil Rights Act has been generations coming. It's been coming since the first slave ship landed on the shores of Virginia. This is a bill that's been sung on the plantations and the colored-only meeting halls. This is a bill that rode the Underground Railroad. This is a bill that fought and died at Gettysburg, waving the banner of the Union and abolitionism. This is a bill that marched with MLK and his quarter million... demanding freedom and equality under American law. We shall now stand on the precipice of a new American era of American history. This new era will surely be one of true American patriotism, a nation coming together to celebrate our commitment to freedom, equality, and brotherhood. Because we are not all Americans. Are we not all deserving of the same opportunities and rights? If we pass this act, we will have one thing that they will never have in Germania. We will have a nation united and working tirelessly towards a true, free democracy. And we promise you this democracy will always win in the end, and now we just have to hope that the Senate agrees. It only takes 51 years. Surprise in Birmingham. The sun rose over the house of a young black family in Birmingham. The only son had taken through the radio to his room the night previous and accidentally left it on. From it came from the voice of RFK. My fellow Americans, I come to you today to speak to you of a new era of Americanism. Earlier today, the U.S. Senate voted narrowly to pass the Civil Rights Act and is now sitting here right on my desk ready for me to sign. I want to take the time to explain to you what this new act will do after I signed it. The act will secure a solid, equal chance for Americans regardless of race, color, or creed. We finally shoved Jim Crow with his one foot in the grave entirely into the said grave, and we're not stopping here. The radio woke the boy from his fitful sleep. He jolted from his dream of white hoods and burning crosses into his Birmingham bedroom. The golden sun was flowing through the blinds in his window, filling this room with a bright yellow hue. A sleepy, dark-skinned band reached to turn the dial. Or hand, not band, hand. In 63, I stood in this very same spot to tell you all that I had a dream, and dream of an America that I knew was soon to come. An America where we were all Americans, not white Americans or black Americans. I stand here today to tell you that we are ever closer to that dream. Even now, President Kennedy is signing into law the Civil Rights Act, and the very act that will build the foundation for the America which I dreamed. Again, that same hand, sleepy hand, reached out and turned the dial. And that was A Change Is Going to Come by Sam Cooke. Now for the weather. What a beautiful sunrise over Birmingham. You can expect warm, sunny days ahead. Today, expect a high of... That sleepy hand reached the dial one time more, this time to turn it off. The boy put on his shoes, stood up, and went outside. He wanted to look at the sunrise. We did it all for you. The American despair becomes the American malaise. Where is that? The American despair. Oh, there it is. Oh, we're despair. May God help us all. Woo! Okay, so we get more political power, recruitable population, stability, war support, remove integrated... military? Wait, what? Military integrated racial minority protections. Integrated minority protections, so you give them special status. Remove segregation. Ooh. Not special segregation. Okay. And what else we get? Equal rights. Increase the status of civil rights. We did it all for you. Did we pass it? Basic civil rights legislation. Did we do it? This act is the foundation for further social progress. Thanks to effective enforcement methods, we are able to begin desegregating the South's schools and workplaces. The black community generally agrees that more needs to be done, but we are pleased with what we've accomplished so far. The polls are updated. Great. And this is all during an election year. Jesus Christ, we're nuts. Oh, boy. All right, so let's see. The West Coast is good. The Rockies are looking good as well. Look at that. The death of a Thai guy. The Great Plains is looking pretty good. The RD campaign crashes and burns. Let's not get cocky then. Upper South, the Deeper South. Look at that, the Deep South. Looking really RD. East Coast is looking not bad either. Not bad. I just want confirmation that we actually passed it. Like I know that we had that event, but... is that all we get? Fight for workers. If I do this, we're going to get killed off. We lose money. At this point, the root of the issue, injustice everywhere, I don't mind doing increasing the organization of free nations, like unity, so let's do that one. Justice prospers where rightly guided laws are duly enforced and adhered to by all. Conversely, improperly implied laws which liberate are as dangerous as improperly applied laws which oppress, for the former demonstrates the government's incapacity to dispense justice wherever needed. Justice requires cooperation between both intent and practice. Deprive one of the other, and tyrants blossom where good men ought. Thus, it cannot be gainsaid that every injustice heard to have occurred in this supposed land of freedom is a threat to the very freedoms that enshrine as law, and the justice which they should cultivate. I saw it, MPP campaign, great. Get England on the side. Cool. Our influence of the pact will increase by 71.5% every month. That's a lot of influence. Improve relations with Himmler. I thought they died. Yeah, I don't know, man. I don't know. I don't think I'm going to do this stuff. Political landscape, 13. Towards the root of the issue today. President RFK spoke to the nation about the Civil Rights Act he had been instrumental in passing. Upon walking to the podium on the stage of the Capitol building, he was applauded by the supporters in the audience, and once the applause had stopped, he began a speech. My fellow Americans, we have all united around the concept of freedom in a way I could never have thought possible. The passage of the Civil Rights Act is an extraordinary step for all of us, but today, our struggles are not over. While the equality we strive for has now been codified, we must maintain our commitment to the downtrodden across America and refuse to withdraw into complacency. Unfortunately, we must still come to terms with the root of the issue. Across the country, the remnants of prejudice continue to fester, many unabated by the legislation we've passed, while the blatant and ugly efforts of states to segregate the races of America have been dashed. The echoes from earlier times have nonetheless persisted. Too many of these institutions are a fact of life, for good or ill, but our nation was not founded on the principles espoused by America's founders. I call on all citizens of the U.S. to look at ourselves and our society critically, and question some of the things we take for granted. The un-American attitudes of racist groups have lost their stranglehold on politics, but that does not mean they've been vanquished for good. Confronting these uncomfortable aspects will not be comfortable or enjoyable, but it's something that we must do as a nation if we ever plan to move forward. Only through examination can we make our country a safe and inviting place for all of Americans. Thank you all. We will persevere. Ooh, more stability. All the President's Men blows the lid on the box office. Hollywood took on the political wildfire of the President Nixon presidency this past weekend as a critically acclaimed film, All the President's Men, stormed theaters across the U.S. Critics from the Chicago Sun-Times have regarded the movie as being a brilliant showcasing of the depths of investigative journalism, as paranoia, self-doubt, and harassment dominate the cases of both the heroes of Washington Post. The movie soared to reach a cemented number of one spot at the box office as Americans rush to see the political thriller. Director Alan J. Pakula provides American audience a journey across the spheres of journalism, writing, and politics as a film looks into the journeys of renowned reporting duo Catherine Graham and David Haberstam, as they take on the haunting shadows which peer over their every move. Together, the duo forms one step after another in the journey to unveil a secretive and dangerous conspiracy involving the White House administration, scaling all the way up to the former President Richard Nixon himself, who just 2 years ago resigned from his office as President of the U.S. Graham and Haberstam served as a writing leads behind the movie itself, with Graham stating that David and I wanted to deliver a truck through the perils that came with the Nixon scandal as we'd experienced, terrifying, back-breaking, and, well, exhilarating. As every time we felt our hearts racing, we wanted the audience to feel that the rush just the same. That being said, key figures within the Republican Democrat Party have come forward in criticism of the movie, with the Republican Democrats stating that it puts a hole through our work in trying to help the U.S. Meanwhile, spokesperson within the National Progressive Party has stated their appreciation with the Graham, Halberstam, and Pakula's work. Nevertheless, despite political experts' criticisms, the American audience has driven in scores to theaters across the country to enjoy the film of the decade, as some have called it, a critical success despite our failures. Cool. Congressional situation. We can only have 40 votes, of course. Cool. Fight against poverty, campaign where we haven't, I don't know. We'll see what happens. Let's see, we still do great plans, I guess, some more. I mean, even if we campaign, there's a still chance we screw things up, so... Let's do... we can go back to the Deep South. Let's go with the... Great plans. There we go. 345 factories, never enough. How are we doing here? Oh god, we're continuing to run out of things to build. After that, it's going to take a while to do this, but put up a nuclear reactor in Utah. Nuclear Mormons. That's what we want to see, right? Here we go. Death of a Supreme Court Justice. Sad news is coming from over the wires. One of the senior most justices on the U.S. Supreme Court has passed away. A conservative, they wrote several notable opinions throughout their tenure, both in concurring and dissenting. In addition, they were the swing justice in more than one case. However, with a solemn moment comes an opportunity to change the balance of the highest court in the land. We'll have to get the right nominee and manage the Senate process carefully. But if we succeed, it'll be a major victory for our administration. Let's fill the vacancy. I'm going to continue to increase influence a little bit because we've got over 1,000 right now. And there should be an event that pops up fairly soon that'll give us the choice to do so. You know, I'm going to cut construction spending now. Just because we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, some. the nomination of Thurgood Marshall. In a press conference that dominated headlines across the country today, President RFK has announced that Thurgood Marshall, currently a judge on the U.S. Court of Appeals for the Second Circuit, will be nominated to the newly vacated seat in the Supreme Court. Marshall, a graduate of Howard Law School and experienced a civil rights litigator, would be the first African-American to serve on the highest court in the land. His appointment would surely mark a turning point in American history. However, some in Congress are not so willing to appoint turn in the first place. Many senators come from the South and are directly reliant on white voter blocs who aren't well disposed towards putting a black man on the Supreme Court. Several members of the Senate have already put out statements to the press expressing their firm opposition, although nobody has really come out and said it would be due to Marshall's rights. Instead, the releases mention the dangers of liberal judicial activism and other such phrases. Clearly, the appointment of Thurgood Marshall will be a political fight for the ages. The right thing, the right time, the right man, the right place, I hope. He will need to be confirmed by the Senate with a vote held in 15 days. You can find out the status of the confirmation in the decisions menu. But you know what? I think that'll be a good place to stop for today's episode. I guess we've passed civil rights. So, hope you enjoyed the episode, guys, because we have elections coming up as well. But regardless, if you enjoyed it, consider leaving a like. Subscribe if you're new. Check out my Discord link in the description below. And thank you to everyone who's already subscribed and liked the video. But I will see you all tomorrow as we continue with our journey with RFK, and hopefully he doesn't die. Thanks for watching. Have a great rest of your day.